Hey everybody, it's Wade and Isaac with Mudcrab Milsim here to talk to you a bit about our recent Airsoft event, Wargame Oklahoma. This was our fourth year for Wargame, and it was an absolute blast.
Yeah, it definitely was. We had a lot of great people come out. The battles were very intense this year. Some of the best I've seen, and it seemed like everyone that came out had something positive to say, and you know, it made us real happy that we could put on such a great event for everyone. We want to go ahead and thank a couple sponsors. We had an absolute amazing raffle this year. This year four was our best year ever. Just tons and tons of giveaways. So I'm gonna go ahead and thank some of our key sponsors we had. We had E-Bike send us a couple guns. They went over the top this year for us. Patch Forge, which is the ones that do all of our patches, they sent us some patches on them, and it was great to have those extras for you to give away to you guys. We had US Tactical. They're always great to have out as well. Rescue One, they were out and they were ones taking care of everybody this weekend or that weekend because they needed it. It was really hot, so they took care of some heat cats for us, got them off the field and taken care of and stuff like that. We had JTC come out. JTC gave away a lot of awesome things this year, and that's one of our partners, Gus. He went above and beyond this year for giveaways. So we were really happy to have his home field, JTC, out to our event as well. Huge shout out to Overwatch. Overwatch hooked Greenside up this year. They even took care of the water raffle that Dan Rollover hosted, and he actually gave away a Glock 17 during that, which was pretty cool. And Overwatch actually brought out a lot more stuff for us, and then a lot of internal stuff for us this year as well. So we huge shout out to them. KWA sent us a Rani T10, and man, was that thing beautiful. So big shout out to KWA for that. And then E-Bike Outpost showed up. It was Kurt and Jason Terry. I actually met Jason a long time ago. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful guy. I can't speak highly enough of him. Absolute amazing person. And they showed up last minute and brought out, like, I think it was like a total of four guns and like 40 ammo cans to give away, which was insane. And then our last sponsor this year was actually US Elite. And then US Elite sent us two pair of Solomons. Well, sent us one pair. And then gave us a giveaway code for the other pair. So they gave away like $480 in boots.
Yeah.
Which you don't really see every day, but I thought it was pretty cool for US Elite to do that. So big shout out to them as well.
And a huge thanks to Incredible Edibles for providing all of those sweet, sweet fudge bars at the end if you stayed for the raffle.
So much food. So much. Such good food.
This year, we've changed a little bit of our theme and all of our command staff. We had a great time working. New commander this year, William Soto for Wargame. He's a very experienced airsoft player, a keystone pillar in the community. He went up against JTC. Gus, we asked Gus if he would run TAN this year, and he decided that he wanted to be with his boys on the field and lead you guys into one of the hardest fights I think I've ever seen out at the D-Day field. But both commanders seemed to have a really good time, and they brought out some awesome crews to run their company. That chain of command is core to this exercise, and we cannot make it happen without the help of squad, platoon, and company level leadership. Additionally, we couldn't have made it happen without the help of all of our staff, all of our volunteers, everyone from FOB referees to OBJ babysitters. It takes a lot to do anything out there at the D-Day field. It takes a lot to just get your car out there in one piece sometimes. Yeah. And so without them, we couldn't do what we needed to do, and we couldn't have taken care of our players as well as we did.
Just, and everyone sees staff members, always tell them thank you. I know I do at all the other airsoft events I go to. Because they put in a lot of work and effort in the game, and a lot of effort into making sure you guys are safe. So, without staff, you don't have Airsoft. So, always thank your bus driver.
Always thank your bus driver. Some of the teams that made it out this year: JTMG, Joplin Boys, represent Minions of Mattis, the Mando Bros, very cool guys. Talon Tactical, TF171, the always spooky Oogie Boogies. The Raptors, Task Force Podcast was on the list, Death Raiders, Airborne, ARK, Skeleton Crew, Task Force Misfits, SEMO, Huckleberry Airsoft, the Guys Out of Wyoming, Archangel Airsoft, the 6mm Maniacs, Rod Airsoft, the Nebraska Legionnaires, and Team Rogue, Jamie, Ridge Runners, Outcast Airsoft. Thank you, everybody who made it out. We love to see teams come out and represent on the rosters. It's great when you bring your community out to an event and you can hit the field with your squad. So, all right, moving on to the actual debrief section for this video. This year's event, we changed themes. We left Eastern Europe and have moved to the Korean Peninsula. We've changed the factions from NATO to Warsaw to the Eastern Forces and the Western Forces. And this year's game saw the players fighting over the brutal terrain of North and South Korea. There are three ways to win War Game Oklahoma. There are resource points, which are generated by the controlling of special sites across the field. These are capture zones or depots. For every interval a side owns one of these objectives, they get a special point that they get to spend on an airstrike, a chemical strike, or something special like that. Next up, there are Frago points. Frago points are special missions handed down through the chain of command. These missions are specially tailored to the units that they are assigned to. So at War Game, you have a company level command, and below that, you've got platoons. And so you've got an infantry platoon, an airborne platoon, special forces platoon, and a mechanized platoon. And each platoon has a bank of missions that are tailored to them. Sometimes the missions link into each other, and sometimes they're just one-off, one-and-done things that generate points for your side. The last way a side can win War Game Oklahoma is what's known as shenanigan points. Shenanigan points are anything that encourage an atmosphere of camaraderie and sportsmanship at our event. These are hilarious or honorable things that we observe both on and off the field. Winning this category gives your side bonus points that could break a stalemate if you are otherwise tied. So moving on, we're going to get straight into our favorite category because it's the most memorable, shenanigans. So this is not an exhaustive list of every shenanigan conducted, because the nature of shenanigans, it's impossible to observe every epic and stupid moment that takes place throughout the course of the weekend. That means the best way for you to win shenanigans for your side is to make sure that your epic moment is captured on video or with cameras. Okay, so our first shenanigan is the Ballad of Bob Part 1. Part of this year's game included a special frago given to the company commanders that required them to elect a special sensitive item or mascot for their side. These mascots must be protected at all costs, both on and off the field. There are rules of engagement to this, which we will detail on our rules page. But the level of hilarity hit an absolute extreme this year just because of how new this shenanigans system was to everybody. Mere hours into the game, the Western headquarters managed to snatch the East's sensitive item and proceeded to do all kinds of terrible things to it, probably violating more than a few articles of the Geneva Convention. Soto showed up and was like, oh, so what's this about the shenanigans thing? And we explained it, and he's like, okay. And we didn't see him until the next time we talked to him about it was he had already captured the other side's sensitive item, which was Bob the Dummy, as everyone saw throughout the weekend. So plus two shenanigans to the West for more than one successful Bob snatching.
Soda really did a really good job of embracing the shenanigans. He's, you know, he wasn't really familiar with it to begin with, but he's like, hey man, this is your event. This is what you guys do. I'm diving full in. And he had like two or three guys out in front of his camper with nods on and like Nerf guns armed at the ready, like running patrols throughout the night for their holy hand grenade, just so they wouldn't get stolen.
The two sensitive items were the holy hand grenade of Antioch, as you can see on the screen, and Bob the Dummy, as you can also see. I am not going to show the gallery from Bob's Night Out. But if you want to navigate to our website, it's an adult theme. So if you're a minor, avoid it. But it is plus one shenanigans for the West for documenting Bob's night out and sending it to the Facebook messenger of the enemy command. The next shenanigans that we're going to talk about are the night game. So if you're interested, there's a full AAR on Facebook about the night game. We hope that you enjoyed it. We changed things up a little bit with the Hypno Rave theme. We are aware that at the end there was a bit of a communications breakdown, and things kind of got confusing with the old factions thing. We promise moving forward that we're going to be a lot better at distributing mission-specific things. Like if there is a third faction that might become hostile at some point, we'll make sure to communicate that beforehand so you know when it happens what exactly is happening. However, part of the confusion wasn't entirely on us, as when hearing that the Special Forces have gone rogue, players from both sides, without prompting from any of the staff, formed impromptu alliances with each other to hunt down their Special Forces. So for the night game, we actually combined the Special Forces for both sides without telling them. And gave them a common objective, which they had to work together to complete. When they got their objective, which was the DJ out of the church, they had to get him to Xville. It was at that point that all the players were to turn on their Special Forces while also still fighting East and West. It was a little bit muddy. We could have done a better job of explaining that. But to see East and Western troops working together, unprompted, to hunt down their Special Forces and to block them off of their exfiltration site was just beautiful. We had a lot of fun watching a lot of the shenanigans break out on those missions. So plus one shenanigans to the East for making some noise. There's a Facebook video of them hooping and hollering before the game. Plus one shenanigans to both factions for their Special Forces teaming up to survive the rest of the group and to get to their extraction. And then plus one shenanigans to both sides for forming those impromptu alliances to hunt down their Special Forces. The next shenanigan we're going to talk about is the Ballad of Bob Part 2. So after his eventful night, Bob was taken by Western forces to the church and tied to the second story as a morale boost to the troops. Bob flew for most of the day until about 1 p.m. when Eastern forces managed to recover and free him. So plus one shenanigans to the West for making an example of Bob. Plus one shenanigans to the East for not leaving a man dummy behind. The next shenanigans we got is sea shanties. So also on the Facebook, on the way to battle, a squad of Eastern forces broke into song as they bumped along in the Deuce and a Half. Anybody who's ridden in Deuce and a Half knows it's a rocky ride, and so they must have been feeling pretty inspired. Plus one shenanigans to the East for bringing the sea shanties. The next one we got here, Twinkie Eating Showdown. So after the grog, there was a challenge, a Twinkie Eating Challenge. Overruled by the president of the grog, the company commanders for both sides were not allowed to elect champions to compete for them, and they had to eat the Twinkies themselves. So plus one shenanigans to both sides for getting on their knees and going to town on some Twinkies, and plus one shenanigans to the West for Soto winning the Twinkie Showdown.
My boy Soto likes some Twinkies, man. That wasn't a competition. I'm sorry, Gus. Soto's a big dude, and he likes his sweets, man.
All right, next up, we've got Joe's Snatch. So,
this is my favorite shenanigan.
It is my favorite shenanigan from the weekend as well.
I died when I heard this one.
So, in an effort to make up a points deficit on Sunday, Eastern forces were outnumbered going into the Sunday game and were doing their best to hold on all day. A lone Eastern forces player named Joseph Gilbert managed to infiltrate the Western FOB and snatch the sensitive item, their holy hand grenade, and make a break for it. In the process, there was a weapons violation, and the two sides decided to work through the situation, and what ended up happening is the Western forces gave Joseph a 10-second head start. He could take the holy hand grenade and run as fast and as far as he can before the West would release a squad of absolutely rabid airborne to run him down and retrieve it. Isaac, you had something to say.
When you say rabid airborne, you From the stories I heard, they were like chomping at the bit, like jumping and almost like tweaking out just to make a sound, just to go hunt this guy down. If that doesn't sum up Luke and the Death Raiders, then I don't know what does, because they're absolute nuts.
It's just that is absolutely true. So plus one shenanigans to the east for snatching that grenade and making a good run for it. The next up we got is sword duels. So again, some point on Sunday, Eastern forces began challenging the West to sword duels. The West and the East were great sports and met in no man's land to have it out. So plus one shenanigans to both sides for having chivalry. Plus one shenanigans to the East for winning the first duel is caught on video on the old Facebooks. That was pretty impressive. Next up is the infamous Eastern Forces Conga line. Again, as part of a strategy to close the gap on Sunday, the Eastern Forces unleashed their ultimate weapon, a conga line. So, plus one shenanigans to the East for getting down with it. Next up, we have the Western Forces mop test. So again, toward the end of the day on Sunday, Western headquarters thought it would be a good idea to test to see if their troops were chemical attack ready, and purposefully dropped a chemical strike on a friendly position on the north side of Colville. Plus one shenanigans to the west for making sure their troops are ready for anything.
It might not have helped that I may or may not have dropped an extra 4 to 6 smokes on top of them.
Well, if they. Next up, we have the Humvee yelling flirtations. So the Western Forces Humvee that showed up, they were awesome. They were great. They were giving out water all day. They were cruising around, whistling and making everyone just feel awesome about themselves.
Making love to you is all I want to do. Love.
Everyone has had nothing but positive things to say about the Humvee. They personally helped me get to a heat casualty that went down in a ravine in the backfield in the first half of Saturday. And they, I said, "Hey, we need a fast mover. Can you help us out?" And he said, "Get in." And so, awesome shout out to those guys. Plus one shenanigans to the West for their vehicle being always helpful. Miscellaneous shenanigans. In no specific order, plus one shenanigans to both sides for the two players that were observed holding hands, a green and a tan player holding hands, skipping across the battlefield. Plus one shenanigans to both sides for the green ghillie sniper and the tan rifleman who came together to work out a uniform malfunction. There was some confusion about whether or not his ghillie suit was green or tan, and the tan player explained that to him, and the green player said, "You know what? You're right. Let's add more green foliage to it and let's fix this issue. We don't need to bother an admin for this. Let's work it out like sportsmen." And that was really cool. Miscellaneous shenanigans. In no specific order, plus one shenanigans to both sides for the two players that were observed holding hands, a green and a tan player holding hands, skipping across the battlefield. Plus one shenanigans to both sides for the green ghillie sniper and the tan rifleman who came together to work out a uniform malfunction. There was some confusion about whether or not his ghillie suit was green or tan, and the tan player explained that to him, and the green player said, "You know what? You're right. Let's add more green foliage to it and let's fix this issue. We don't need to bother an admin for this. Let's work it out like sportsmen." And that was really cool. So at the end of the day, the West came out on top in the shenanigans category. However, it was relatively close. So the winners of this category got an additional 3 victory points. However, as you'll see later on, the West didn't necessarily need those to claim victory at this year's event. So moving on to the last couple things that we've got, we're actually going to break down the mechanical scorings for the Frago and resource point metrics. This year's event required the sides to elect 4 landing zones for their airborne before the game. They also got to pre-position an anti-aircraft site, which denied a zone of coverage of 4x4 grid squares. In addition to that, they had to find and protect their depot from enemy hands in order to respawn vehicles. It's very interesting to see the strategies for both sides unfold throughout the year. And now we're going to just talk about phase one, the Saturday morning game. Western forces won this phase, winning an overall 14 points between the resources and the fragos. Eastern came close behind with 10 points. The Saturday game ended slightly early. We had a medical emergency in the backfield and had to call a real world. A player went down in a very inconvenient location, and in order to preserve the safety of that player and of the players assisting him out of the ravine, we called game a little bit early there.
The phase one with the heat cat. So we decided to go ahead and call it a little early, the game early, just because of the fact that we didn't want all our players sitting out in the sun for that long. And by the time that we would have even got the player out, it would have been time for lunch anyway. So we figured, why not break early, come back into game early, just so we can, you know, get you guys out and to play airsoft a little bit longer. You know, we didn't realize weather would tie into that. So,
right. So phase one, a very good opening to the event. I had a lot of fun watching that game unfold. At the end of phase one, the Tan forces had a airborne chalk outfield toward Pegasus Bridge, and the Western forces had some special forces and airborne deployed around the field. So we reflected those deployments moving into the second phase after lunch. Due to the weather, we ended the game prematurely due to lightning. This phase was an even draw. I will say, however, from the ground, on the field, and from the Western FOB, Tan had a very, very strong push at the beginning of this game and made it to within 100 meters of Old Pond. We were watching it all unfold in the valley. It was very, very intense. Tan also had their Humvee on the field for this one before it went down due to electrical issues. But they were very well organized going into the second phase, and if it weren't for lightning, I do think that the Green would have had a run for their money in that phase, and it was unfortunate, but player safety always comes first. Next year, again, we will relay these contingencies a lot better during orientation. This was our first ever rainout, so moving forward, we'll definitely be able to squeeze more gameplay in after a weather event, because everyone will know exactly where to meet and what is going to go down.
Yeah.
All right, phase three, Sunday. So going into the Sunday game, there was a numbers discrepancy. This tends to happen. Attrition is a part of combat. And if you are not taking care of your troops, and if you're not taking care of yourself during Saturday or during the parties Saturday night, Sunday you will not have what it takes to take the field and be effective. The winner of phase three are the Western forces by a rather considerable margin, but again, that isn't for any lack of trying on the eastern part. As we saw, the shenanigans campaign was very hard fought, but at the end of the day, the West really just brought it and did a super good job organizing their troops and keeping everybody in the fight and playing that long game. The East had a lot of new players, this year, who had never even been to a milsim before. This was their first time at D-Day, the first time at a milsim, and so a lot of our Eastern Forces squad leaders were focused on making sure that those players had a good time and saw action. And even though it wasn't a super close game, it was still a very very hard fought and a very action-packed game all the way until the very end. Wouldn't you say, Isaac?
Yes. And, you know, to add to that, not only with it being, you know, very well fought on both sides, but the amount of respect and just camaraderie and sportsmanship that I saw on each side was insane. Everyone was having a great time that we saw. I mean, even the Tan players that were, you know, were stuck in FOB, a lot of them were still having a good time, you know, talking about all the cool stuff they'd done during the week. You'd have Tan and Green players talking on the field just randomly as they were walking back to FOB, you know, saying, hey, great job. You know, you guys are putting up a hell of a fight, and this year's been absolutely amazing. And that was coming from both sides. And was what is as a promoter, when I see that, it makes me feel so good, because that makes the community so much better. And the people that are there want to come back because they see that and think, oh, these guys are really cool guys. Not only the fact that they get to play airsoft, but they get to talk to everyone and have a great time with everyone, not just their own team. So, huge shout out to the players for being able to take the heat and the weather, and being down by some points here and there, and just being able to have a good time no matter what happened. So, thanks guys, I appreciate it.
I agree, that's very well said. In closing, we're just going to hit you with a couple things. Based off of your after-action reviews, there's some things that we're definitely going to implement moving forward that we'd like to share now. So one thing that we definitely learned this year is dispersal of information is always key. Anything that's going to change or any extra elements that are going to appear in a scenario by game's end need to be communicated before the game even starts, so that when it happens, everybody's plugged in and knows, oh, this was supposed to happen if this condition was triggered. So that's a big one. Second, I believe we are going to invest in a ballpark stadium PA system in order to give out staff announcements to the campgrounds and to play music at you at early morning hours to get you up and moving and chronoed and registered. We noticed that dissemination of information, admin presence in the camps, anything like that that we can improve upon is just going to help ensure that the average player is more plugged in to the experience and more plugged into their chain of command. Radios. The radio tables are going to become public knowledge for next year's event. We're going to keep our company command nets OPSEC, but your average squad's radio is going to be a fixed matrix that will not change from year to year, so that you can ensure that your comms equipment is set up well in advance and that you have everything that you need to plug into your chain of command. The last thing that we're thinking of implementing for the next year is an informational docket given to you at check-in. This contains coupons for the vendors, a schedule, a map, an explanation of all the objectives that you're seeking out, the names of your commanders, and ways to contact them, and where to go if you are lost or have questions. We've seen systems like this succeed at big events like Oklahoma D-Day, where they needed to onboard 2,000, 3,000 players. And we're hopeful to implement that just as effectively at Wargame Oklahoma. Is there anything else that you want to say in closing, Isaac?
Nope. Well, just as always, thanks for coming out to Wargame Oklahoma. It's always a pleasure having you guys. And can't wait to see you the next one.
Can't wait to see you at the next one. Watch our Facebook for notifications. We're going to be posting our schedule for next year here in about the next week. Lots of exciting things happening. We're going to have a new airsoft event as well as open plays at D-Day a lot more frequently moving forward. And so we're super excited about all of that and excited to see you again. Thanks for watching.
Thanks, guys.